Okay, we're back. The next 2 hours is devoted to Virginia Mason, and we're very happy that they have come to join us. We, like Claudia said, we've been partnering with them since 2010, and some of you may remember coming to this room for our first stroke education. This is my partner in crime. This is Jenna Kelleher. She and Sarah Jane DeVoe are going to be partnering as stroke coordinators and that type of thing. And so Jenna came over to be with us and meet you guys, and we'll be here to visit. And then Dr. David Robinson is in the back. He's going to introduce himself, but I get to introduce Dr. Brown. Dr. Wendy Brown did her residency at UC Davis with a fellowship in vascular neurology at UC Davis. She worked at Sutter Medical Center in Sacramento for the last 5 years before coming to Seattle. Presently, she's at Virginia Mason as a neurohospitalist. She's double boarded, certified in vascular neurology and neurology. Her academic interests include intracerebral hemorrhage, TIA, and medical ethics. She's widely published. I looked at her bio and I was like, and so we're really honored to have Dr. Brown here.
Thank you. Again, my name is Dr. Brown, and I'm going to be doing kind of just an overall lecture about the comprehensive care that happens in the hospital of the acute stroke patient. So in terms of the objectives, first I'm going to go over the definition epidemiology of stroke and why it is an emergency. Then the main thing I'm going to focus on are the indications for TPA, including the newest guidelines that just came out this last December, and then indications for neurointervention, as well as best practices in the stroke unit. Just a little blip on that at the very end. So, definition of stroke. So, a stroke is caused by focal brain damage that's caused by an occlusion of an artery, usually a blood clot. Risk factors for stroke include hypertension, high cholesterol, atrial fibrillation, coronary artery disease, diabetes, carotid artery disease, clotting disorder, smoking. List goes on, actually. And non-modifiable, age, sex, race, and family history. In the United States, there's about 800,000 strokes per year. Only about 50 to 70% of stroke survivors regain independence. That leaves about 5 million stroke survivors with substantial morbidity. 18% are unable to return to work, and 4% require total custodial care. 22% of men and 25% of women die within a year of the first stroke. And so, while a lot of people do recover from stroke, about 25% make a full recovery, there's a substantial number, a little bit less than half, that are left with either moderate disability, severe disability, or dead. And so the idea is to try to change the outcomes of stroke so that we leave more survivors with less disability. So how do we do that? The idea with stroke is that there's a blood clot that is blocking blood flow to the brain. And kind of imagine a sprinkler with grass not getting enough water, that there's not enough blood supply to the grass, and then that area of grass dies. And that area is called the core infarct. However, around the area, there's an area that's going to be at risk. It's fed by collateral blood flow, so it's still getting some supply. So the idea is to try to reestablish blood flow by removing that clot and thereby reducing the amount of core infarct, that we can establish blood flow to the brain before that area, the penumbra, dies. Here's another picture, basically, the core infarct, and then the area that's at risk. So, quiz question. During a stroke, how many brain cells are lost per minute? 1,000, 2,000, 50,000, or 2 million? So, it's estimated that we lose about 2 million brain cells per minute. And so, for every minute that the brain is left without blood flow, 2 million brain cells are lost. So that's why we always say time is brain, that the quicker we act, the sooner we restore blood flow, the less core infarct there is. Here's another example. This is an MRI picture. also demonstrating what I'm talking about. So this is an area on the right side of the brain that under fusion-weighted imaging, this area is already infarcted brain, but you have this whole area that is at risk because there's a large blood clot that's preventing blood flow from getting to that area of the brain. So the treatment for stroke really changed in the 1995 with this article called the NIDS trial, the NINS trial. This is the trial that found that TPA was effective in terms of reducing the disability of stroke at 3 months. So this is what we call the modified Rankin scale. 0 is no disability, 6 is dead. 0 to 1 is minimal disability. You can see here that patients that got TPA within 3 hours compared to patients that didn't get TPA, they did a lot better, that there were more patients with a modified Rankin scale of 0 to 1, which is minimal or no deficits. So patients with TPA have a 30% chance less risk of disability if they're given TPA compared to patients that did not get TPA. There's a risk though. So anytime there's an area that has any stroke, that area is at risk. Those brains are fragile. And so in the study, 6.4% of the patients did have an intracerebral hemorrhage. That area of infarct did bleed, and 3% chance that it can be fatal. Extracranial hemorrhage is extremely rare. If you go through any risk factors for bleeding, we'll go through those. Those are the contraindications for TPA. So risk factors for hemorrhage, age, the older you are, the less blood flow you have, that your arteries basically might not be as good, so that you don't have as good blood supply feeding the rest of the brain, so that you're at more risk of bleeding. Same with the size of the stroke. So based on how large your stroke scale is, or the NHSS, or based on the size that you see in the CT, you're at higher risk of bleeding. Also, patients that have elevated blood pressure at the time of TPA or right after, a systolic blood pressure of greater than 185 or 110 are at risk of bleeding. And also hyperglycemia, so a blood sugar greater than 400, are at risk for hemorrhagic conversion. To make sure that there's no risk of bleeding, either intracranial or extracranial, the study did look at these, or did list these exclusion criteria. And these are the guidelines that we used, or the exclusion criteria that we used until very recently. And just to go through them really quickly, because I'm going to go through them again when we talk about the new guidelines. So any suspicion of a subarachnoid hemorrhage, history of stroke, serious head trauma, or intracranial surgery within the last 3 months, history of a prior ICH, history of GI bleed or urinary hemorrhage in the last 21 days, history of major surgery within the last 14 days, arterial puncture at a non-compressible site or lumbar puncture within the last 7 days, any intracranial pathology that could possibly lead, like a mass or AVM, aneurysm, abnormal serum glucose less than 50 or greater than 400, there's also relative contraindications. These at first, I think, were actual contraindications, but in the last few years were made relative contraindications. But giving TPA. Major deficits, again, that's patients that have a severe stroke are at higher risk of bleeding, and a large stroke on the CT, so hypodensity greater than 1/3 of the cerebral hemisphere, elderly patients as mentioned above, and also seizure at onset of stroke. And the reason for that was, again, to exclude in the study any stroke mimics. So seizure, you can get a Todd's paralysis afterwards. It can be people that have a seizure disorder can be left paralyzed on one side afterwards. That could look like a stroke. So there was a paper done afterwards that looked at all the studies of TPA and found that for every patient that was treated, the number needed to treat to be normal near normal was 8.3 and improved was 3.1. And for every 100 patients treated with TPA, 32 would benefit and 3 harmed. So basically, yes, there's a risk of hemorrhage. But the reason for this is that the risk of hemorrhage was so feared that it needed to be shown that the benefit of TPA outweighs the risk. And here's another slide that it shows this. So, and this is actually recommended to show to patients, so it makes it easier to decide if we're trying to talk to family members about the risks and benefits of TPA to make it easy for them to understand the statistics. Like for every 100 patients, that about 10% are going to be left with better impairment. About 30% are going to be improved, or sorry, 10% are going to be have minimal deficits. 30% are going to have some improvement. And about 33% are going to be harmed, so 3%. The rest is going to be no change. So also talk. The example of these. Contraindications to TPA, you want to exclude any hemorrhage, any mass, or any large area of frank hypodensity that could be a subacute stroke. So this is what you're trying to exclude when you get a CT of the brain. So any hemorrhage, any hypodensity that could be an old stroke, if the patient doesn't have obvious last time known well, or this is supposed to be a mass, any mass that can bleed or be causing the symptoms. But you could see, so this is called what we call a DensMCA sign. So this is the middle cerebral artery feeding the left side of the brain. And then if it looks brighter than the right, that means that there's clot there. So that means that there's a big clot in that artery. Here, the MCA artery can come around. There's something called the dot sign, so that's also clot right there. It could be that subtle. And then you can also rule out subacute strokes. So early you get, in the first few hours, you can get blurring of the gray-white matter junction. So you can see here, it's a little bit different than the left. It's very subtle, but the gray-white matter junction, so the differentiation between the dark area and the light area is blurred there, and you get less sulci. So you can see that area is a stroke. And then later on, as the stroke goes on, it becomes darker and darker. So this is gonna be after 4 days. So in determining the area that's already infarcted, there's something called the aspect score. And this helps us give us an idea of how much area is already infarcted and how much area is going to be at risk. What is there to survive? And I just want to show you again, when you're looking at stroke, the idea is that you want to reestablish blood flow before the area of infarction. So we look at these areas, we look for obvious frank hypodensity and try to determine, okay, is this area big enough that that area is already infarcted and it's not worth the risk? So with TPA, in 1995, that trial was published. In 1996, the FDA approved TPA for use of acute ischemic stroke in the first 3 hours. The European Medicine Agency in 2002, which is the FDA equivalent, followed with approval in Europe, but they gave two requests. One is they wanted an observational study, and one was they wanted a randomized trial in which the window for TPA for IVs extended. And so, here's a quick question. Despite the fact that we know that TPA is effective, how many patients, what percentage of patients get TPA, would you estimate? 4%. So that's the reason why they wanted the study to extend the window for TPA, because only 4% of patients with stroke receive IV TPA. And the average time of onset to the time that medical attention is sought is usually 13 hours. So delay in time to arrival is the most common reason TPA is not given. The other reason for extending the window for TPA is that 3 hours is not an absolute. So this and areas of Farkin is more for hemorrhage. But the benefit basically, even beyond 3 hours, still goes beyond 3 hours. And so in 2008, this trial was published. It's called the ECAS-3 trial. And this was a study similar to the original trial, but it was looking at whether TPA versus placebo was effective within the 3 to 4.5 window. This was done in Europe with 821 patients. Similar criteria, except they excluded any severe stroke or a stroke greater than 1/3 of the MCA territory on imaging. A combination of previous stroke and diabetes, or patients on any anticoagulation, even if the INR is less than 1.7. And again, it was found that it was effective. So 52% of patients versus 45% of patients that did not get TPA did well. And again, here's the modified Rankin. So 0 to 1 is going to be minimal deficit, 6 is going to be severe deficit, and more patients that got TPA did better compared to placebo. And just want to repeat the slide, so just because it can go up to 4.5 hours doesn't mean that you have more time to treat. So a patient should initially be evaluated within 10 minutes of the ER arrival by a physician, with a stroke team notified within 15 minutes. CT scanner should be done within 25 minutes, with an interpretation by 45 minutes, and that ensures about 15 minutes to mix TPA so that the patient is given TPA within 16 minutes. So basically, anyone that's a candidate for TPA that arrives in an ER within 2 hours, unless there's a contraindication, should get TPA. And since then, we've actually become a lot leaner with TPA, that we've become a lot more aggressive. And I'm just going to go through a bunch of other little studies that have been found that have kind of developed and have changed the way that TPA has been treated just in the last few years, actually. So there's a study called the Helinsko model. Basically, 1 hour didn't seem to be good enough, that they wanted to do better. And they got their TPA time down to 25 minutes. And the protocol they used was ambulance pre-notification, so that the patient's taken to the emergency room and directly taken to the scan on the same gurney, so that they're not taken to the room and then transported later, delay that time. And administration of TPA directly in the CT suite. So basically, the stroke team meets the patient in the scanner and then can give TPA right in the scanner. And this kind of shows how, once they developed the protocol, how their times improved. The other concept that has been developed recently, this is actually more in academic centers. I just kind of wanted to share it with you because it's kind unit, you have a CT scanner, and then this is telestroke, so you have a neurologist on telestroke. So you have the entire stroke team basically with the neurologist on telestroke that can give TPA, and the scan's already done. And then telestroke has also become a lot leaner. We do that here so you know what it involves, but it used to be that telestroke would be a stationary, big stationary place the neurologist that's on call, such as myself, would have to go out of their way to go to their office, go to their little station to do telestroke. But now, with the technology developing as it is, you can actually do pretty good telestroke consults with just an iPhone or iPad, and this is supposed to show you how good the imaging is. So again, it allows a lot more flexibility in terms of the stroke team. So The other thing that's recently developed that I'm going to focus on a little bit is to expand the number of patients that receive tPA. The AHA looked at the guidelines for the indications for tPA and exclusion criteria. And this just came out in December of 2015. And the reason for this, I think these guidelines actually were a little bit late, that they were kind of a long time coming. That people that were really comfortable with stroke, they got used to bending the guidelines a little bit and treating the individual and case-by-case basis. The reason for that is that these guidelines, the exclusion criteria really developed for the study, but we know that every case is different. So for instance, the risk of the bleeding might be very minimal. Say the patient has platelets of 97,000, but a huge stroke. Well, what's the risk of the bleeding? We don't really know. That was just an arbitrary number picked up. Or if a patient has a minor bleed in the brain because they fell as a kid years ago, are they really going to be at risk for bleeding again, you know, if it's an 80-year-old patient? And so this graph shows you this is a pool of neurologists, experts in stroke. And what this is showing you doesn't come out very well. But this shows you the percentage of percent of experts that would go ahead and treat with these exclusion criteria. And the one thing that I think most people didn't feel comfortable treating was actually the coagulopathy. So they're on Coumadin with an INR greater than 1.7, most wouldn't. But for instance, secured aneurysm, that's not likely to bleed again. Most neurologists, about 50%, felt comfortable. Or traumatic ICH years ago, that's not likely to bleed again. Say if it's a small traumatic ICH, then a lot of neurologists felt comfortable treating. So again, case by case, individual basis. So I'm gonna go through the criteria a little bit quickly. And I think right now, if you have questions, you can ask because it is a little bit dry. And again, these are individual cases. So there is still, to kind of summarize the criteria, really, it is that a lot of times we don't know, and you have to take the risk and weigh it against the benefits. So things that were definitely removed, so seizure at onset was removed. The original guidelines I mentioned wanted to rule out a Todd's paralysis, but some of the times strokes can present with seizures, particularly if it's a cardioembolic stroke, and usually these are the big strokes, the big cardioembolic strokes. And so if it's an obvious stroke, they still think that you should treat. Severe stroke, they have been shown to benefit from tPA. Mild stroke, the exclusion criteria was removed. About 3% of patients with mild stroke actually go on to have severe deficits, especially with lacunar strokes, so these small strokes, they can wax and wane, and they've been shown to benefit as well. Patients greater than 80 years old, that criteria has been removed, and rapidly improving has been removed. So, tPA is now recommended for older patients greater than 80, severe strokes, and mild strokes. And these are grade 1, highly recommended, that it's been proven. Again, these were old contraindications or relative contraindications. And just to really quickly summarize with older patients, the reason why for older patients it's approved is that even if they're at higher risk of bleeding or that the tPA might not be as effective, they're not as likely to improve, that there is a certain percentage that do respond. So among patients treated with tPA within a 3-hour time window, for every 1,000 patients treated that are greater than 80, there'd be 96 more alive patients and independent at the end of follow-up. So 28% of patients who receive tPA versus 93% of controls. So again, they're more risk of bleeding, but they still can benefit. So these are the criteria where they say it's not really proven, but it's reasonable because probably the benefit of tPA is not worth the risk. So arterial puncture at a non-compressible site. I'm thinking mainly of patients that have cardiac casts that afterwards have a stroke from the cardiac cath, they can still benefit from tPA. So again, complication of cardiac catheterization, unruptured aneurysm, greater than 10 millimeters, history of an extra-axial intracranial mass, that's a meningioma, seizure, dural puncture last 7 days, suspicion of a carotid artery dissection, or suspicion of conversion disorder. With conversion disorder, so patients that you aren't sure whether patients that might be faking a stroke, that they might just be highly anxious and their exam is very questionable. The guidelines now state that it's better to treat, that there's minimal risk of having a complication, and they still might have a stroke, and you can't waste time determining that. So they say that for TPA might be considered, but further research is needed for moderate disabling, non-disabling strokes, rapidly improving strokes, pregnancy, the early postpartum period, but they recommend consultation with a gynecologist, and trauma within the last 14 days without major head trauma. So there's some exclusion criteria that still stayed. Coagulopathy, especially if the INR is greater than 1.7 or with thrombocytopenia. Low molecular weight heparin within the last 24 hours. They actually said both prophylactic and therapeutic doses. Usually with the prophylactic dose, as long as their coags are fine, I would still give it actually, I think, if it's a big stroke. One big question is whether it's safe to give with Eliquis or Lartropredoxin now that more patients are on it. There isn't a lot of research on that, but because of that, they say that probably it's not worth the risk. Severe head trauma within the last 3 months, recent intracranial spine surgery or prior stroke in the last 3 months, patients with a structural GI malignancy or recent bleeding within the last 21 days. So patients with minor GI bleeding, it might be worth the risk, but patients that have a real reason to bleed again, a structural lesion that still might bleed or is actively bleeding, still a contraindication. Patients with an intraaxial neoplasm, so this is mass within the brain, not like a meningioma. History of ICH, wake up stroke greater than 3.5 or 4 hours, as a specific aortic dissection. So with these exclusion criteria, I'm kind of going to go through a couple of cases. And the question for all these cases is whether you would give TPA or not. So case one. 63-year-old male lawyer who presented with acute onset of difficulty speaking after getting some sedatives over the phone. He had clear refraining difficulties, but otherwise has no weakness, and his NHS is only one. So this is a mild stroke. But however, by the time the CT is done, his aphasia has improved, but he's still having some trouble putting his thoughts together, and speech is still fragmented. Vital signs are stable. Labs are normal, and the CT is normal. So the question is, would you give TPA or not? How many would give TPA? Yeah. So even though his stroke scale is just one, and even though it's improving, this is a young guy, young lawyer, he's still practicing. So this is where probably the benefit of TPA outweighs the risk. In terms of, and that's kind of a question that these exclusion criteria leave for debate, is again, if it's mild, how disabling is it going to be? And so most people would say, well, the patient can live with the deficit. So a 90-year-old female that might have a little bit of slurred speech probably wouldn't give TPA. But a lawyer that is still practicing that has fragmented speech is probably worth the risk. It would probably be life-saving for him or career-saving. Case two, 70-year-old male with hypertension, last seen normal the night before when he went out to dinner with a friend. His patient's son found him this morning on the ground with right-sided weakness. His vital signs are stable, labs are normal, and this is a CT. Give TPA? No. It's a subacute stroke. Last seen normal outside the time window, so this would be a contraindication. So case three, so 90-year-old female with mild dementia, atrial fibrillation, not on Coumadin. She's fairly independent, she lives in assisted living. She presented with acute onset of aphasia and right-sided weakness, witnessed by her family at dinner, a normal 1 hour prior to admission. Her stroke scale was 20, so this is a severe stroke. Her blood pressure is 168 over 94. She's in atrial fibrillation. Labs are normal, and this is the CT of the brain. And quick question, does anyone see anything abnormal in the brain? Can you point out? Yeah. The dense MCA sign, which fits with her symptoms, that we know that it's a left MCA stroke feeding the left side of the brain, causing aphasia and right side of weakness. So 90-year-old female, would you give TPA? Right. So even though she's 90 and this is a severe stroke, she might have more risk of bleeding, she is less likely to do well, but there's still a good proportion still can respond to tPA. So with this case though, patient after the tPA still has an NHS of 20 as the tPA has been administered, so now what? Brings me to the next conference, beyond tPA. So near intervention. So near intervention is for cases that have a large vessel occlusion. So these are occlusions that are in the major branches going to the brain that we can get to within 6 hours that do not respond to tPA, have a contraindication to tPA. So if the patient was on Coumadin, this last case, and had an IA of 1.8 and can't get tPA, she'd be a candidate. Or outside the 4.5 hour window for tPA. So then what do I mean by large vessel occlusion? So again, these are the major branches when I talk about stroke. So we're talking about the basilar artery, intracardiac artery, and middle cerebral artery. And the easiest concept that I think of when I explain this to patients is imagine a branch. And if you have a clot to the tree, the bigger branch, obviously a larger part of the tree is going to be affected, versus if you have a clot on a small little twig, the stroke's going to be smaller. So then why does it matter? Well, even a patient is treated with tPA, with these large vessel occlusions, only 30% of patients will respond to IV tPA. So basically, the larger the clot, the less likely they are going to respond to tPA. Concept is that if the clot's big enough, that they're not going to respond to Drano, and you're going to have to go out and actually get the clot out mechanically. And so, as I mentioned before, only about 30% of patients respond if they have a large vessel occlusion to tPA. This shows you the large vessels and the response rate. So the largest vessel, the terminal ICA, only 5.9 will open up with tPA. The middle cerebral artery, only 30% will open. The basilar artery, 30% will open. And these patients, if they don't respond to tPA, are going to have higher mortality as well. So you can see here with the terminal ICA stroke, terminal ICA occlusion, that is, it's going to be a 45% mortality. Here's another graph showing you that the prognosis for large vessel occlusion is higher. So this graph shows you the lighter color is the large vessel occlusion. This shows you the mortality and the stroke score. Again, the higher the stroke score, the bigger the stroke. So patients with large vessel occlusion are more likely to have a higher stroke score and also are going to have a higher mortality rate. And this is the reason why. This depicts exactly what I mean by large vessel stroke and small vessel stroke. So here, this is a big left MCA stroke. This is a small vessel lacunar stroke. So how do I identify a large vessel stroke? So one way is a neurological examination. These are patients, again, are going to have a more severe stroke, so they're going to have a higher stroke scale. They're going to have aphasia neglect and a visual field cut. It can also be seen on a non-contrast CT with a dense MCA sign, as I showed to you, early infarction on CT or a CT angiogram. Yep. So this again, dense MCA sign. And then here is a CT angiogram where you can actually see, so this is the right MCA, this is the left MCA, so imagine this is the same patient, and there's a cutoff there. So that we know that there's a clot sitting there blocking the blood flow to the brain. And here's another thing that we can get from a CT angiogram. This is with what we call a multi-phase CTA. So we can determine how good a candidate the patient is going to respond to tPA or respond to neurointervention. So if they have good clotal flow, I mentioned good clotal flow helps keep that area of brain alive, then they're more likely going to respond because there's more brain to save. So here you see good clotal flow. This is an example of poor clotal flow, where you're not going to see as many clotal vessels compared to here. So the idea is that area of the brain is already infarcted, has poor clotal flow, that they're not going to respond as well. So really, neurointervention has also gotten a lot leaner, I mean, in the last few years, that in the last couple of years, we had these new devices. These are the next generation, the third generation stent retrievers. And we use right now usually the Solitaire device and the Treva device to do mechanical extraction of the clot. Here's an example of what we see when we do it. And Dr. Robinson is going to give you more examples and show you videos of this. But basically, this is the internal carotid artery, middle cerebral artery, the anterior cerebral artery. There's a cutoff there. There's a clot blockage there. And then the clot was extracted. Flow is restored. And it's just recently, although neurodivention has been around a lot longer, again, these retrieval devices have just come, been available in the last few years. And so it's just recently that we've had an outpouring of studies, four major studies that have really shown the benefit of neurointervention. And I'm going to go through some of them. So there was the Mr. Clean, the ESCAPE, the Extend IAA trial, the Swifter trial. The first major one was the Mr. Clean trial. It was 500 patients with stroke within 6 hours that were randomized to just medical management, so TPA if they were candidates, and just admission for supportive care versus medical management, TPA if they were candidates, plus neurointervention. And 33% of patients that had neurointervention had minimal or no deficits compared to 90% who were treated medically. So again, with the modified Rankin scale, 0 to 1, so over here, is no major deficits. And so patients that got neurointervention, versus control, were more likely to do better. The ESCAPE trial, another trial, just want to show you their numbers. So 53% that got endovascular treatment versus 29% did well. And here's a picture kind of depicting the numbers needed to treat. So medical treatment, 29% might respond. You have a significant number of 52% and 90% that are left disabled or dead. Versus endovascular treatment, 53% have good prognosis versus 37% and 10% death. And I just wanted to show this. I bring this up because one time I did an intervention case on a cardiac patient, and a patient that had a stroke after cardiac catheterization. The patient didn't recover well, and the cardiologist wanted to know why not. Like, you got the clot out. And just thinking like a cardiologist, like, if the clot's out, then the patient should do well. But even that, if the patient does get endovascular treatment, that there's still a significant number that are going to be left with impairment, that we do, they're more likely to do better, but we don't always save everybody. And then the Extend IA results, same thing. So 70% patients with acute stroke with less than 4.5 hours with TPA, that got TPA, randomized to intervention or not, and 71% versus 40% had functional dependence at 90 days. And so just kind of want to tell you the people that we have, our team that does the intervention. So there's Dr. Cerrone, Dr. Crane, and Dr. Robinson, who will be giving you more examples of actual cases that we've done after my talk. And so this is kind of the way I think about how we treat stroke once a patient gets to the ER. So if a patient has a stroke within 6 hours, it should be an immediate stroke code. In less than 4.5 hours, they should be considered for TPA. If it's a contraindication TPA, you still have to be thinking about large vessel occlusion, or if they got TPA, still think large vessel occlusion. And once, if they have a large vessel occlusion, then be taken to the neuro-IR suite. If there's no large vessel occlusion, then it's gonna be best medical management. And so really quickly, the thing I wanted to touch base on for those of you that practice in the unit is best practice of the stroke unit once the patient's admitted after they are in the ER, after they got the TPA. So the Joint Commission measures ensure best practices. So I just want to go through them really quickly, that for primary stroke centers, that TPA should be considered for all patients within 2 hours unless contraindicated. They should be screened for dysphagia. They should get stroke education, DVT prophylaxis, a lipid profile during the hospitalization, plan for rehabilitation, antithrombotic medication started at day two, and prescribed at discharge, and anticoagulations prescribed to patients with atrial fibrillation. I do want to point out that these are just the best guidelines, that they don't replace common sense as long as it's documented. So if a patient, say, cannot get Coumadin or cannot get anticoagulation because there is a contraindication, then as long as it's documented, that's reasonable. So patients that are admitted to a stroke unit, they're monitored for neurological deterioration, hypertension, dysphagia, hyperglycemia, fever, and DVT prophylaxis. And this just wanted to throw this slide in that patients that actually admitted to a stroke unit have less incidence of mortality, and then a higher percentage of them actually go on to be independent and live at home. In a stroke unit, we monitor blood pressure, and elevation of blood pressure greater than 160 are seen in about 60% of all strokes, and it usually declines within 24 hours. The question of how to treat the blood pressure in a patient that did not get thrombolytics, once a patient's admitted for supportive care in the unit, it's a little bit, it hasn't been well established. The idea is that if you have low blood pressure, that you might decrease the perfusion to the brain. High blood pressure might increase the risk of edema or hemorrhagic transformation. And so the AHA guidelines basically say that there's conflicting data, and so the recommendations are really conflicting. But that a reasonable goal is to lower the blood pressure by 50% within the 24 hours, and most people will hold off on treating the blood pressure or starting on the home blood pressure medications and treat only blood pressure greater than 220 and 120. However, patients that are treated, that are eligible for TPA in the ER, that to minimize the risk of hemorrhagic conversion, that their blood pressure must be lowered less than 185 over 110. So dysphagia is most common for aspiration pneumonia, and it's the risk of aspiration pneumonia is reported to be as high as 30%. It's most impacts patients with palatal weakness and patients that are greater than the age of 70. And so the Joint Commission states that we have to get a swallow evaluation for every patient before they take anything by mouth, including medications. And then DVT prophylaxis. So DVTs are found in about 20 to 75% of stroke patients. And so they're required to be on some DVT prophylaxis, either heparin, sub-Q, and isoparin or sequential devices. And I want to state that if they're on sequential devices, that the Joint Commission also the Joint Commission also states that you have to document it. So basically, they're not going to know if the DVT prophylaxis is not on unless it's documented. So I just want to show this slide showing that with all these treatments for strokes, with everything that I've gone over the last few years, that since 2012, that the stroke has dropped from the third to fifth leading cause of death since 2012. And then just end with this slide, the change of survival. So stroke starts with pre-notification with the ambulance. So recognition in the community and by the ambulance, pre-notification, in the emergency room that the stroke team is activated with streamlined protocols, that they're admitted to the stroke unit to prevent complications, work up for secondary stroke prevention, admitted to rehab for physical therapy, speech therapy, given education for risk factor modification and to learn the symptoms of stroke for early recognition. So that way, again, there's more recognition of stroke and better prevention. And that's it. Any questions? Yeah.
So one of the very common patients we have described the rapidly improving patient, right? So we have those rapidly improving patients by the time they get to the ED. supposedly are back to normal. You know, so we try to roll them into the TIA pathway.
Right.
But I've never met this person. My nurses have never met this person. Sometimes we have family members.
Yeah.
You know, luckily we have family or friends that say, no, they're completely back to normal. But it's hard to tell when you're saying we're going to treat someone with an NIH score of 1 when we don't know them and they're supposedly have improved in the last 30 minutes. What do you suggest for those patients?
So again, it's a case-by-case basis, and the guidelines now state that it's still an area of research. What they state is, but what's unknown, what it defines that as a case-by-case basis is, again, what do you mean by rapidly improving? Like, how much? Do they go from a stroke score of 15 to 6, then it would still be reasonable to treat and not wait to see if they get better. They recommend that you don't wait to see if they get better, if they still have deficits. If they go to...
Is it a patient that was unscored at home and now is a 1? You know what I mean? So they're...
Yeah. And so if it's 1 with a, you know, 9-year-old woman with, you know, maybe slurred speech, yeah, probably you wouldn't treat. If there's no evidence of any large vessel occlusion, you don't expect that it'll get worse. Again, it's a case-by-case basis. But with that being said, again, 30% of patients with mild strokes or rapidly improving strokes can go on to have worse strokes. But usually it's going to be the ones that still have some kind of measurable deficit that you're kind of concerned about, usually more strength-wise.
So are there any studies being involved right now on the classic TIA complete resolution but well-documented deficit that completely resolved and giving them lytics in a period of time? And is there some studies out there for that?
Yeah. And sometimes when I'm really on the fence, I mean, you're not supposed to wait, but if I really am not really picking up much deficit, I will try to actually find a deficit to treat. So I'm like, you know, not using it as an excuse not to treat, I'll try to find something to treat. So I'll have the patient walk, you know, can they walk okay? You know, if the patient still has a little bit of hand weakness, have them write. And again, it's a case-by-case basis. But usually, yes, a measurable deficit, in a typical case, I would still treat. If it's, again, questionable, maybe that a facial droop, maybe some slurred speech, probably not.
Then the second question, since we had a prior lecture, a reversal of, obviously, our anticoagulants, are there any thoughts around reversing the anticoagulants with these antibodies and others within that correct window to be able to get lytics?
I'm sorry, so what are you? So
someone's on warfarin. We can reverse it rapidly within that period of time they're having a stroke so that they are not a contraindication.
It's not, that's actually not in the guidelines. You know, and actually, yeah, the answer is, yeah, it does, to me, it doesn't make sense to do that. I mean, you're giving something that can cause, you know, that can cause more thrombogenesis. So it doesn't make sense. Usually those cases, again, you try to do the next step, which is going to be intervention.
So I noticed that in some of the studies that we mentioned, diabetic patients were excluded for some of the studies that we have with TDA. Given that this is one of the most diabetic areas of the country, do we have any good data coming out with some of the newer studies that do support the use of TPA or neural intervention in a patient who may have questionable glycemic control?
Sorry, so trouble hearing, sorry.
So do we have any data that include diabetic patients or patients who have diabetic vasculopathies that would, do we have good evidence that they would also benefit from these, or that diabetes modifies the outcomes with these interventions?
Are you talking about, are you talking about with the exclusion criteria for the exclusion? You know, are you talking with the extended window? Are you talking about with the hypoglycemia?
Right, so my understanding is that many of these studies excluded diabetic patients.
You're talking about the extended, yeah. And so I never understood the reason for that, why that was excluded with the history of stroke. It didn't really make sense to me. And it's just an exclusion criteria. And actually the, you know, the guidelines with those exclusion criteria, the fact that they're a little bit more lenient for beyond the window, say it's still reasonable. As I said, the guidelines for the most case now say case by case basis. So severe stroke, diabetes, history of diabetes and stroke, probably still get it.
So do we have any, do we have enough resolution in our data then to be able to tell whether or not diabetes is a modifying factor for the outcome with an intervention with either TPA or neural intervention? Do they have better or worse outcomes? Do we know?
I think it's just a hypoglycemia. Okay. And the risk, yeah, I think that, and I'm not sure if that was the thinking behind that exclusion criteria, but then they already have the, they already had the glucose greater than 400 as exclusion, so I never quite did understand that, and no one really, no one could answer, no one did, so.
So when TPA was first brought on the scene, it was one-time TPA and never give it again. Is that still the case? Or say you got TPA a year ago, you had another event, say today, am I eligible for TPA?
Yes, just not within, not 3 months afterwards if there was an actual stroke.
So as you saw in the video, this is Dr. David Robinson, one of the interventionalists, and he's gonna introduce himself.
Hi there, welcome and pleasure to be here on the drier side of the let's see, a couple of points. First off, this is going to be kind of a rapid fire multimedia stuff, so just sit back, you know, if we had popcorn we could pass it out, pretend you're watching a Nova episode or something, and just soak it in. You don't have to, there's text slides or graphs, I'll point to exactly what I want to call your attention to, so you won't have to sit and figure out how to interpret things. And then actually I was thinking I might just start. So I'm David Robinson, it's VM, neuroradiology, neurointervention radiology, been there since 1998. And since that time, it's been my pleasure and privilege to perform thousands of minimally invasive procedures, including hundreds and hundreds of angios and hundreds of stroke interventions. I'm going to start with this one, just so you guys see. This is a patient who comes into the angio suite with a stroke scale of 29. For those who have, I assume we have a pretty wide range of, background knowledge here. But this is what we're talking about. So this man comes in. He's got complete hemi neglect. He's looking off to only one side. He's flaccid on one side. Facial weakness. I mean, he's pretty much out of it. We're going to see me. The medic is describing his deficits. I'm going over to the other side. Mr. H, where am I? He's not going to look over at all. So that's a profound hemi neglect, profound hemiparesis. This is very likely to be a fatal stroke. That's a lot of brain involved right there. So that's a patient presented with a stroke scale of 29 who did well after this sort of intervention we're going to talk about, by the way. So let's go back then and jump in here. I've got my little mouse thing set up here so I can, I need to be able to navigate around. So this is the new building that this sort of stuff's done where I work at Jones Pavilion. And the floor in particular for these interventions is a pretty cool design. They have this hallway of a bay of rooms where you come in one side, then you go out the back way towards the procedure rooms. And every one of these rooms is sort of set up like an ICU room, these admit recovery bays. And so if there's anything acute going on, they have everything they need there. So they come in one door, go out the other door, and then into this, for these sorts of cases, biplane neuroangiography suite. So here's what a biplane neuroangiography suite looks like. You know, it's like $5 million room there where you have simultaneous frontal and lateral fluoroscopy, but also very sophisticated electronics to process the data that we get so that we can get 3D models and 3D imaging of, in this case, vessels to the brain. So for instance, like this case of an aneurysm, where here's a 3D rotational angiography, and here is an intracranial aneurysm that's gonna be treated. In this image, we're planning out a stent so you can do device planning with virtual sort of reality where it tells you what size stent, how long it's gonna be. Here's the treatment with the balloon-assisted coiling where I've got a balloon device and then the coils going into the aneurysm, and then post-treatment after stent-assisted coiling, you just see the dots at either end of the stent and then the coils inside the aneurysm. This is replacing open surgery in the large majority of patients now. You just get it done from a puncture in the groin. So, and this is the kind of room that facilitates doing that sort of thing. And here's another just, you know, dramatic case of a basilar aneurysm on rotational angiography, the 3D image that we generate, and then this is post-stent assist coiling of that large basilar aneurysm. The surgery for that would be horrendous. Okay, so we're now talking about ischemic stroke, and I have way more than I can show you, so I'm going to try and keep track of time. We're going to skip through. What I want to do is give you the history, because I've kind of been there from the beginning of this, and show you how it's evolved and how our techniques and devices have evolved, and go through some cases. These are going to be successful cases. They're not all successful, obviously, but these are the ones that get us up in the middle of the night, you know, and motivate us. And it's not uncommon that you get this kind of outcome that I'm going to show you. So with intra-arterial therapy, it encompasses originally just going up and giving clot-dissolving medicine right into the clot instead of just getting into the IV, so local intra-arterial fibrinolysis or thrombolysis. But then also banging on the clot with something, balloons, wires, whatever, again, mixing it in, trying to mix up so you can get up and agitate, because this is the problem we'll see with IV tPA, is it can't penetrate into a large thrombus. And then you have the ability of emergent angioplasty and stenting as well, either of the carotid or intracranial circulation. So it provides a whole lot more options than just giving IV tPA. So some of this is going to overlap with what Wendy just showed you, and I'm going to be able to race a little bit even faster through those parts. But this is a really nice little demonstration here about what we're talking about, the theoretical underpinnings of, you know, how we treat stroke and why, how we can, you know, help these patients. So you have start with an embolus that's blocking blood flow to the brain, and then there's typically a deep part of the territory, but not always, that is so profoundly hypoperfused, lack of blood flow, or ischemic, that there's just no chance of saving that brain. It's irreversibly injured by the time they reach the hospital. But surrounding that area, so we call that the core, surrounding that area is the penumbra that is going to, the core is slowly going to grow into that penumbra, and that's our target, is that area that's hibernating, contributing to the symptoms, but if it we can restore blood flow, we'll reverse the symptoms and result in a better outcome, you know, down the road, sometimes even by the next day. So those are those important terms and things to understand. And the question we sort of alluded to earlier, so how long can brain tissue survive without blood flow? Anyone want to venture a guess? You know, we got about the 3-hour window and the 6-hour window and the 4.5 window. 5 minutes. So we have to have some blood flow. The brain cannot survive. If somebody goes down with asystole, cardiac arrest, it's brain death in about 5 minutes. So the point is, it's not no blood flow. There's dramatically reduced blood flow, and the brain goes into hibernation, and you have a little window of time in some patients to reverse the situation. Here's a little diagram showing the importance of where the clot is. So somebody embolizes something up into the carotid circulation, and this is more about the theoretical underpinning. So here's a study that they did where they put oxygen sensors over the surface of the brain and mapped out locations in an animal model, and then essentially induced middle cerebral artery stroke, and measured the level of oxygen delivered to the brain, and then monitored symptoms. And that produced this classic diagram, which is sort of has everything you need to know about the hemodynamics or the issues of lack of blood flow and reduced blood flow to the brain. So I'm going to go through it a little bit. It's good to understand. So if you have enough blood flow, in this case it's rated as mils of oxygen per 100 grams, but just enough blood flow, then you have normal function. So even if you've tied off a vessel, if the collaterals were adequate, the animal may not display any symptoms or person. But as you drop down below a certain threshold, then they start to have stroke-like symptoms because the brain can't function. And so you start to see the symptoms, but it doesn't mean it's immediately irreversible. And how long it takes to get into this irreversible injury territory depends on the depth of the lack of blood flow, the depth of ischemia. So if there's really no blood flow, as I said, it's only 5 minutes. But the brain does have typically some alternative routes of blood flow that might backfill into a territory very slowly enough to keep that brain alive. And so depending on how good those collaterals are, you can have a couple of hours or even, this is interesting, that inflection point's at 3 hours, but even for weeks, you can have hibernating brain. This is where maybe advanced imaging can help us decide whether, because what we're after is this blue territory, right? We want to save the brain that's in here, and there's no point in and deal with this. So this is what this is all about. How we image those, so infarct shows up on just a non-contrast CT or diffusion weighted MR as brain injury. And then these areas that are hypoperfused but not yet dead take some kind of perfusion type studying that we'll maybe talk a little bit about. But so there are ways to image this. Okay. The NIH stroke scale, I'm sure you've all heard about that. So it's a pretty easy to learn, reproducible exam that just gives you a score. And the point of getting that score is it has prognostic value and you know, can hint to the possibility of a large vessel occlusion also. But so here is the original TOAST trial. And what we're seeing here is the red curve is the likelihood of having an excellent outcome after a week, and the yellow curve is after 90 days. So for instance, if you have a stroke scale of 20, your chance of being, you know, functionally independent and having a good outcome, even at 90 days, are not great. And in a week, it's almost zero. This is with standard medical therapy, you know, aspirin and supportive care. And so this is useful when you're thinking about likelihood of a good outcome. There was a couple of questions earlier, a question about stroke scale of one. Well, if you look at this chart, that patient is so likely to do well, you know, IVTPA with a stroke scale of one is maybe a little questionable. But, and the question about the TIA, my answer to that is the issue with that patient is at high risk for having a stroke and needs to be worked up and treated, you know, within 24, 48 hours for why they had that TIA, not just sent out to follow up with somebody 2 weeks later. That's what's being emerging in terms of the data about TIAs. Okay, so this is about important of the location of the embolus. If somebody embolizes up into the carotid artery and it just lodges in the distal carotid artery, they may not have any symptoms at all because there are connections to the base of the brain that may allow flow around up into the brain. And if these are adequate, the circle of Willis connections, there may be adequate blood flow to the brain that there are no symptoms from a carotid occlusion. There are lots of patients out there that have carotid occlusion and don't even know it. The problem is if some, either the circle of Willis is inadequate or some of that kind of breaks off and heads up into the brain. But if you move up a little higher and you get what we call a T occlusion, this is a completely different situation. Now you cut off all the blood flow that could come into the circle of Willis, and this is one of the most severe forms of stroke, typically is these T occlusions. You go out a little further and you're in the first part of this middle cerebral artery, what we call the M1 segment, and you've blocked off those little perforators going into the base of the brain. And so those, you know, can only tolerate that for so long. And then if you go out a little further, out into the M2 or distal M1 segment, here's a situation where you might have a little more time to get out there and open this up. And one of the better situations, they're all good actually right now for current endovascular therapy because of the advance in devices, we can deal with all of those. But originally, that T occlusion in the old just giving TPA would be a very difficult thing to overcome, where this would have been more feasible. Now, you can also just have a shower of distal emboli, and the presentation may look the same. You can't necessarily tell on exam if someone showered out distally, they still have that same territory that's contributing to their symptoms, so that can be sometimes difficult to distinguish. Okay, so here's the difference between IV and intra-arterial therapy. With IV, TPA, you give the TPA and it goes where the blood flow is. So it interfaces on the surface of that clot, but it can't penetrate into a centimeter long thrombus. There's no blood flow there. Where if you get up to that clot with a microcatheter and you actively manipulate that clot or infuse TPA, you're penetrating into it and much more effectively restore blood flow. So that's the original idea. You know, back in 2000 when I started doing this, with the idea that you got more rapid and more effective recanalization, longer therapeutic window, because the original studies for this sort of thing had benefit up to 6 hours, where that was never the case with IV and still isn't. And then you could significantly decrease the dose you're giving, because we're giving it right at the clot. The dose might be 10 or 20 milligrams. These days we don't usually give any because they've already had IV, but back then we'd give 10 or 20 milligrams into the clot. And so a much lower dose, and you actually get to see what you're dealing with, right? Not just a blind, there's a stroke, I'm gonna give something in my vein. I'm doing an angiogram, I'm gonna understand what I'm dealing with and assess the collaterals and so on. And then it allows for all these other mechanical sorts of devices to break it up, obviously. And if you don't see anything at all, you don't give any TPA, so you avoid giving TPA to someone who didn't need it because there was no clot. Which I have the question mark there because it's probably not much of a risk if they don't have a stroke and they don't have a clot. They probably are not likely to have a problem with TPA, but they might bleed somewhere else, you know, in their body. So that was the idea. So here's a case from 2001, 63-year-old man that comes into the ER with severe stroke-like symptoms of 1 hour after symptom onset. Here is his head CT. So we're all comfortable looking at what we're seeing here. I think of it as like a walnut. The shell of the walnut is the skull. The walnut meat is the brain, and then what would be air on the walnut is fluid, the brain is bathed in, these are cross-sectional images like this. So this is a CT scan, and this is essentially normal. One might wonder whether there might be a little bit of a hyperdense MCA. This would correlate with his symptoms. It's right MCA symptoms he's having. Okay, this patient would be a candidate for IVTPA. Back then, we were convinced this was better, and it wasn't clear you could do both. And so if it's possible, we took this patient on the CT table and went straight to the angio suite. So this is what we found in him. This is a middle cerebellar occlusion. This is that diagram I was showing you. So what we're dealing with here is, this is what it's supposed to look like. Something like this, right? So it's a middle cerebellar, distal middle cerebellar occlusion. And we're missing all this territory out here, okay? This isn't going to play, I don't think. It's missing the media, but you can faintly see this little doubled over microwire. And what I'm doing is I'm spinning that. It's like I call it an egg beater technique. And there really were no studies showing the effectiveness of this, but I'll tell you, it's pretty effective. I'm putting in TPA as I'm going back and forth through that clot with a doubled over wire, just admixing in the TPA and breaking up the clot. So we do that, but it takes a while. So here's a little microwire up to the surface of that clot. And we're going to go through and infuse our TPA in and through beyond the clot. And here is what we achieved after 25 milligrams of TPA. Probably took more than an hour. It's usually nearly 2 hours to do that. But now we've restored blood flow. All that missing territory is back. And here is this guy, day number two. Okay, so his previously paretic face and upper extremity. Now remember, by the TOES trial and the likelihood of having that kind of an outcome, even at 90 days with a stroke scale of 20, was very low. Here's this guy, 2 days later, who's gonna have a very good outcome. Okay, does he have a little neglect still? Actually, just got him up out of bed. He looked at him here. Okay, so that was how we were doing back then. We were doing this in many cases instead of the IVTPA. Then some devices has got attention, so then the device companies get involved and they want to make something to sell you. So there was this thing that came out called the Mercy device, which was just intended to be kind of a spring-like thing you could pull the clot out with. And I'll just tell you, it didn't really work. It was too stiff, it was too hard to deliver, and even when you did deliver it, unformed, and it was pretty worthless, and I felt a little bit dangerous to use. So I wasn't surprised when that sort of went by the wayside, as we'll see. Then they also came out with this one, which was, it's called the penumbra, which was you hook this catheter up to suction, and then you use this sort of cannon prod or deal to sort of pull the clot in and try and suck the clot in and suck it out, okay? And the newer version of this, we're gonna see, has become very effective. This wasn't very good either. So we had these two devices that were offered, and the Mercy device was approved by the FDA, and there's controversy about how it got that approval, because it just really wasn't very good, and they hardly did any. The studies that got that approval were very small. Nothing like you would use need for a medicine. It was much a fraction of the number of cases to get that FDA approval. All right, so in that era then, sort of after 2010 now, an 83-year-old woman comes into the ER, who slumped over behind the wheel of her pickup truck when she was out shopping with her family, and they brought her right in. So she's got a stroke scale of 23, and 12-15 time of onset, she's in the ER within a half hour. We see this over here. You guys are getting these patients within 30 minutes of the onset, and typically they're getting their IVTPA on board. You're doing a great job of getting to that point. Okay, so here is her CT. Non-contrast CT is essentially normal, and this is a CT angiogram where we put contrast in so you can see the vessels, and you can just see this occlusion right here, so it confirms correlated with her exam of left middle cerebral artery occlusion. And in this case, we did do a perfusion test. We don't do a lot of these, but this shows you the perfusion defect correlating with that big left MCA infarct. So we could call this the penumbra. But this, at least on this non-contrast CT, this brain still looks salvageable, but it is not getting a normal amount of blood flow. So here's the angiographic correlate of those findings. It's a proximal middle cerebral artery occlusion. We're going to see a few of these. This is after restoration of blood flow. I think we may have brought the Mercy device up in this case, but pretty much it was the double over guide wire that did this for her. And so there is reperfusion. CT right after, not uncommon to see a little bit of staining like this. This is the area that frequently, if you go back to the original CT, you could see it. Yeah, that was already gone. And so it's an area of infarct where there's breakdown of the blood-brain barrier and you see a little staining. So we just watch those closely, maybe keep the blood pressure a little lower because we don't want this to turn into a hemorrhage. But this is just 12 hours later and that's pretty much faded away, showing that it's just contrast staining in an area of blood-brain barrier breakdown. So the result for this patient, 48 hours later, stroke scale of 1, or stroke scale is 23. Then I'll introduce this idea about the time. So it's all about the time. It's just so important. The sooner we restore blood flow, the better the patient's going to do. So we look at every phase of this and see where we can do better. So this patient was great, was in the ER within 32 minutes, had CT done in 20 minutes. Look at the perfusion study. It's maybe questionable because that added 19 minutes in this case. But then you go into the angiogram. We had some reperfusion. These are interval times, see? So this is each step and then the cumulative time. And it looks like there was some, towards the end, 68 minutes to get final reperfusion from where we got some reperfusion. So a total of 197 minutes or 3 hours to complete restoration of flow. When you can do it within 3 hours and less, you have a pretty good chance you're going to have a good outcome. And if done even less than that is nice. Okay, now comes the breakthrough, and that's this device, is the solitaire. So that this device, what it is like a stent that you deploy, but it's hooked to its delivery wire, so people call it a stent on a stick. And it's actually not a stent, it's sort of like a jelly roll, it unfolds. But the idea is so that it's not a full circle, it's sort of a half circle. The idea is you put this up there and it pushes the clot out of the way and you get some flow going immediately. That's all the difference. You see that and all of a sudden you see the distal territory. Everybody can relax, their brain's getting some blood just as soon as you deploy it, sometimes. And then you let it sit there for a while and the clot kind of becomes adherent to it. And then you pull it out and you hope to see something on the stent. So here is a diagram of that device. And I'm telling you, this was a major breakthrough. So just dramatically reduced the time to reperfusion. So here we've got a clot, we bring a microcatheter up through it, and it's deliverable. Unlike the other ones, it's flexible and deliverable. Here is the solitaire device. We uncover it, hopefully get some flow going, and then you pull it out and you want to see something like this on your device. This is all it takes. That could be a major MCA occlusion right there with a very high stroke scale. All right, so they did a little trial, and basically, for recanalization rates, this is the Stentriever compared to the Mercy device, which we knew didn't work, is better recanalization, better neurologic outcomes, and less mortality. So, c'est la vie, the Mercy device, right? Good riddance. So, now we're in the modern era with the Stentriever, and here comes a young man who was found down up on the top of Snoqualmie Pass and brought into our ER, I believe, but see, we're already 3 hours into it because of the transport time and so on. He's got a stroke scale of 15 with left hemiparesis and heavy neglect. Here's his CT scan, another dense middle cerebral artery, but otherwise a pretty good looking CT scan, so he probably has some collaterals. It takes some time for those changes to show up on the brain. Okay, here's an angiogram of the neck. What we're looking at is the common carotid artery and occlusion of the internal carotid artery. So his ICA is completely gone. It wasn't that long ago you just said there's nothing you can do for this, but he is carotid occluded, that's it, it's game over. But that's far from the case these days. We go after these, and up above that, when you inject another vessel, you can see that he's got a stump of the middle cerebral artery. So he's got tandem lesion, occlusion of the internal carotid artery and a stump of the MCA. All right, so the approach to this is we go after it, we open up that carotid. Here's a distal protection device, a little umbrella filter, and then we open up, tease that artery open, put in a stent so that we've secured access, go up after the clot with the Stentriever device, see how I've deployed that, like in this diagram, and you are seeing flow beyond the clot. So we're getting some nourishment into the brain. And after, I think in this case, one pass with that, we pulled out this clot. Here is his angiogram after just one pass with the solitaire. Here's his CT, looks nearly essentially normal right afterwards. And here he is asking to go back to work the next day with a stroke scale of 1. The carotid occlusion and an MCA M1 segment occlusion and stroke scale of 11, and he's ready to go back to work the next day, or want, asking to get back at it. As you can see, he's a pretty intense dude. So let's see. So here's another one that's we're moving kind of through. Well, this was his timeline. So it took too long for him to get to us. Once he was with us, 15 minutes for head CT, patient in the angio suite 32 minutes later, that could even be less. It took a little while to stent the carotid, but once we had that done, just 10 minutes to put up the solitaire and pull it out, so we got reperfused in 5 hours. He's pretty lucky because that's getting out there. There's not that many that you're going to have that kind of outcome at 5 hours. So this is a patient who had some pretty good collaterals. We would like to do much, get it much quicker than that, okay? But see, we're looking at every one of these times, and this is going to be my message to you. You get multiple phases, multiple people involved. Everyone understands how important it is to move that patient down the line. We're going to get better outcomes. All right, so here's the next one that we're going to spend a little time on. Then we're going to kind of just race through the subsequent two or three. This has some lessons. Here's an 85-year-old with a left MCA occlusion, and she comes in. Here's a CT angiogram. We've got a right middle cerebral artery embolus, stroke scale of 19, and that CT was obtained. CT was about 45 minutes into it. All right. So they gave IV tPA. This was an outside hospital, and the patient was transferred. And this is a repeat CT, 35 minutes from the last one. So she was transferred, repeat CT, within 35 minutes. That's pretty good. It's a little closer to us than you guys are. But what they do here, I'll tell you, get the best right here. They keep the medics on hold. They say, whoa, stroke scale of 19, wait right there. In the ER, onto the CT scanner, no bleed, tPA, back in the truck, and head to VM. That's how you do it. And we got this patient 35 minutes. That's as good as you could get almost when they're in your own hospital, right? And the medics take them and put them right on our angio table. So 35 minutes, or in this case, we got CT. We don't always stop for the CT. So 35 minutes from the outside hospital. Okay, here I was going to introduce this idea of the aspect score that Wendy showed you. Basically, what is her aspect score? It's just a system to try and standardize how much volume of the CT it shows injury on the initial CT, and there's 10 regions, and so normal is 10, and anything, you decrement for every one of these little regions. Notice that there's M5, 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 that's all just M5, so it's just basically far out in the middle cerebral artery. And then the others are sort of these deep nuclei and so on. So what we know, the stroke or aspect score, what's great is 10, right? No injury on CT, that is all systems go. 8 is still pretty good. You start going 7, 6, 5, this patient's probably not going to do so well. It gets to be slim pickings. They're going to not sail through this and not be like the cases I showed you. If you have an aspect score of 6, there's too much brain injury, this patient's going to have a stroke. You still may have a positive influence on their outcome, but it isn't going to be one of these where they avert disaster. So that's the idea with the aspect score. And the other tool that's been developed by this Alberta group is doing multi-phase CT, where you scan once, twice, three times to see those collaterals fill in. And so here is a case where there's an occlusion here, but the collaterals show up pretty quickly. So that'd be good collaterals. And then here's a case where there's occlusion here, and that never really fills in. That's not good, okay? And maybe we just skip it. If we learn more and have better confidence, this might be a patient where it's all core, and there's just no point wasting resources to try. So that's kind of where we are now, is which ones do we might pass on? But also you can use this to conclude someone, like a wake-up stroke, right? The time of onset is unknown, but if they have good collaterals and CT looks normal, that patient is totally salvageable. Even without this, I think if the CT looks normal for a wake-up stroke, we have a good chance of helping that patient. We're back to this MCA occlusion, and here is the angio. You can sort of hidden behind there, but there's a stump in the middle cerebral artery. Okay, let's go up with the solitary device. Here we go. So we've got the solitary device deployed. We've got flow beyond it. This is great. And then we pull the solitary out, and it looks like this again. So go back up with the solitary device, and we deploy it again. We've got flow going, and each one of these takes some time. We pull it out again, and it's occluded. So this is the problem we sometimes encounter. Solitaire multiple times, we pull it out and it looks just like you started. We don't get that nice plug that we're looking for, okay? So here is the next major breakthrough, is we're bringing up this ACE catheter. It's that suction catheter. It's the successor of the one with the little packing mechanism, where they've just developed with very high technology a catheter that can be delivered to the intracranial circulation that's big enough to actually suck something out and doesn't collapse when you put on some suction. So it's a technological, engineering marvel. So we've got a little microcatheter, and this thing is matched to kind of slide right up over that, engage on the clot, and you hook up this suction canister, and you wait a few seconds, and it kind of ingests it and gets a hold of it, and if you're lucky, you pull back and get one of these drumsticks. where the clot's been sucked into the catheter, but it pulls the rest of it out, okay? So after two or three passes with the solitaire device, we bring this up once, get that out of there, and this is what the angio looks like after. So we're frequently seeing this where it's dramatically normal, like you've taken everything out. You don't have, one of the issues is breaking a clot and sending it out to new territory, emboli to new territory, ENT. It's one of the concerns with this, our techniques, trying to reduce the incidence of that happening. So in this case, this basically looks like a normal angiogram now. And the time with this suction device, we spend all the time with the solitaire, but it's so quick. You put that up one past 3 minutes, and these cases that I said took 2 hours are now taking, you know, sometimes it could be 15, 20 minutes. So it's all the difference in the world. So here is her immediate post-procedure CT. You can see, you know, that there's some staining that's very subtle. Here is the MR that she got, okay, some territory. Here's your core, but the MR looks open. And again, the level of injury on the MR. And here she is after 48 hours, okay, so she's still got a little left facial weakness. You can still see a little, hands a little weaker, but I mean, she's got a stroke scale of 3. She's gonna do great, right? If you look at the toe study, a stroke scale of 3 is almost virtually, you know, guaranteed to be independent by 90 days. So it's still a great save. This is, you know, not quite like the last ones, but really a great save. Okay, and so then her timeline, we can pick it up a little bit because I want to show you some data. But what's in red, it took too long to get the first angio. See, these things start to drop out. What happened there? The head CT was great. She was transferred and had head CT in 33 minutes. Stent retriever, but then once we go to the ACE, it was less than a minute. No, and we pulled the plug out. And then so her total time is 4.5 hours, okay? All right, so now we have two amazing devices that are complementary. We have the ability to put the stent retriever across and get a clot like this and get blood flow, maybe pull it out or go suck it. And so then there's controversy, what's the best thing to do? Our current strategy, typically, it depends on how proximal it is, because this might be a little more difficult to deliver. So if it's close, I go for this first, because you can do one pass and you're done. It's just beautiful. And we try that once or twice, and then if that's not working, you're getting more distal stuff, then we go with the solitaire. And you can bring this suction catheter up over the solitaire wire and suck as you're pulling that stent out too. So the so-called Salumbra technique for solitaire and penumbra. Salumbra, we use a combination. So this is extremely powerful, what we've got. We expect to be able to open up these arteries at this point. Okay. So I'm going to skip through, I'm going to skip out of this for a second and just show you a case, here's a nice example of what those collaterals look like on CT, right? We're getting flow over the top of the middle cerebral artery. This is another carotid occlusion with a high stroke scale. And here's this patient the next day, an elderly man, carotid occlusion and an MCA clot, just like the younger man I showed you. Here is a woman with a stroke scale of 30. And here she is the next day, the stroke scale. She's still at a few points. She still has some speech issues, but from a stroke scale of 30 to having 5 out of 5 strength all around. And here is another case, similar case, I think it was a carotid occlusion, and very similar drill. And here is this guy, the next day, right? So we're seeing this over and over. It's not everybody, but you might get something like this in 25-30% of cases now. Something like that. And certainly, in probably at least half the cases, you feel like you made a big difference, you helped the patient. And there's the ones where we're just too late, you didn't help them. And then there are occasionally some that maybe you feel like, I think we may have had something go on during the case, and maybe the patient embolied a new territory, for instance. Maybe they didn't help their original problem, and you gave them more stroke. Maybe we didn't help that patient and actually caused some harm. It is certainly possible. But let's look at the data. So originally all this stuff, the first thing I showed you was based mostly on the PROACT trial, which was an intra-arterial trial that was the most positive stroke trial ever conducted. That was the motivation to head into this territory. So then, it just still wasn't widely adopted. Then in 2013, you may have been aware, there were 3 randomized controlled trials, none of which showed benefit from this strategy. So there's this, wide press, stroke therapy doesn't work and everything. We never believed this because we had too many experiences that we knew this worked. And it's just a matter of problems with those trials, right? And so this, they say, 2002, they question defeats. Everybody sort of deflated. But then in 2015, oh, I'm going to open this back up so we get the sequence. So we had five randomized controlled trials, all dramatically positive, okay? Game over, this is now standard of care. I'm going to talk about the degree of benefit from seeing in these trials, okay? So with better study designs, faster times, careful selection of patients, newer devices, they didn't use a solitaire in those old devices. So this whole game changer device came along in the middle of these trials. I just changed everything. And so now, I'm telling you, if we have hit the sweet spot in this Venn diagram, pick the right patients, you want a high stroke severity, like NH stroke scale more than 10 typically, limited core, so a CT that looks pretty normal, the aspect score is not too high, right? A large vessel occlusion, maybe demonstrated by CT angiography, or just by the fact, virtue of their high stroke scale, and then early and effective treatment with devices and teams that are you know, geared up to deal with this, you are going to see some really nice outcomes. This is what we're seeing, that's what I just showed you. So here is then one of the ways they look at these. Now we have meta-analyses of those trials, right? So here's the top of the pyramid for the evidence-based medicine, right? The meta-analysis. And what we're seeing here is called a forest plot, where it's the odds ratio of improve. So to this side of the vertical line represents favors treatment, and that side favors the controls. And you have the odds ratio and then the confidence interval. So when you have an odds ratio that's well to the right of the line and the confidence interval doesn't even overlap the line, that is a dramatic, you know, clearly beneficial therapy. And you can see every one of those trials was that. For independence at 90 days and also for near normal, you know, excellent outcomes at 90 days, both, which is what we're after. What we tell these patients and their family, we're going for functional independence. That's what this is all about, right? You don't want to live on in a nursing home with severe disability. Okay, but another way to look at this is the number needed to treat, okay? So this is those trials again, and it shows their, you know, confidence intervals and their averages, but this number needed to treat, so ranging from 3 to 7, okay? How's that stack up, you know, number needed to treat? So let's look at that. Here is acute ischemic stroke, thrombectomy versus IV tPA. So this is compared to just giving the IV, right? It's not nothing, it's IV, all right? 3 to 7 patients, okay? What does that compare to? Well, IV antibiotics in somebody getting septic shock. I think we'd all agree that's pretty effective and standard therapy. That's 4, okay? This is in that level of giving IV antibiotics to somebody who's in septic shock. Let's see, what else we have? Because one comes in the ER, the heart attack versus IV tPA, taking him to the cath lab and doing angio and angioplasty. Everybody knows that's standard care, right? You have to do that. 45 to 91 number needed to treat. Here's TPA, IV TPA, it's 8, so it's the better than IV TPA. It adds, the added benefit is more than IV TPA is to begin with. And when you go out beyond 3 to 4 hours, it's even more required. And then say a carotid endarterectomy for someone with symptomatic disease, 6 to 15. Okay, so this is extremely effective therapy. There's another way to look at it. Here is this number needed to treat diagram for those trials, okay, for a STEMI, this is how it looks. Number needed to treat, 17. See, so way better than what going to the cath lab for a heart attack. All right, Wendy showed you this one, Dr. Brown, and this is the IV tPA stack up. So another way to look at this, 100 patients, okay, so 13 get to be nearly normal, 13 more get to be nearly normal because of the therapy, 32 are better because of the therapy, but 6 have intracranial hemorrhage that wouldn't have had it. And 3 are worse clinically because of it, and 1's dead. Okay, that's IV tPA. How does this stack up compared to that? This is going to the cat angio suite. You get 20 nearly normal, 18 better, and there is no increase in morbidity and mortality. Mm-hmm. Do some people die because of some mishap in the angio suite or whatever, an embolized new territory? Yes, but the point is this is added, you know, new, so on top of what it would have been. It turns out we just save way more than get harmed, so there is no increase in morbidity or mortality. Where this is increase, more people are going to get a hemorrhage if you give them TPA than if they didn't get anything, right? So there's virtually, it seems like, all benefit with very little harm. Let's look at some subgroups because, you know, okay, now we have meta-analysis of large studies, so we can start to pick out, You know, some of these things we're concerned about, okay? What about old people, right? It's like, we say age over 80, you know, don't give the IV TPA. Well, now that's been looked at with this therapy, it's one of the best groups, benefits the most, age over 80. what about whether they got IV TPA or not? Does it make any difference? This is aspect score, sorry. So bad CTs. Well, you know, the benefit isn't quite as good, but they still benefit with an aspect score of 6 to 8. Now, if you're talking about this, 0 to 5, this is like a brain that's already kind of wiped out. The slim pickings, right? And so you start to see this where it's still a trend towards improvement, but the confidence interval starts to overlap. And the reason there is you're not gonna help so many, so the number needed to treat goes way up, because there aren't many that you're gonna save. But whether they got IV TPA or not, doesn't seem to make much difference. So some of these patients, like the question about the person on warfarin, cath lab, because we will do someone with an INR 1.7, or on these other contraindications, it doesn't really make much difference if you give IV TPA or not. We still like it, it makes things convenient, and there's probably maybe a little benefit in there, we don't know. But according to this, there's no clear benefit to having had IV TPA before you go to the angiospeed. Then stroke location, this is interesting, and I would agree with this, all these things as we go down here. When you get out further, M2 segment, starting to see that overlap, because it's further out to go, the risk might be going up a little bit, going way out in the middle cerebral artery, and it's a smaller territory to begin with, so there's less benefit, more risk. So we still, and this is totally dependent on the skill of the operator, the device used, and so on. We do go out and go after some of these vessels, but we recognize that the risk benefit when you're starting to go out further may be lower. And then the stroke scale is basically the full range. Used to say, you know, the stroke scale is more than 20, there's nothing you can do. You know, I heard her, I'll just say that years ago. And then I showed you the lady the stroke scale of 30. These higher stroke scales, if we can get to them quick enough, you can still have a really huge impact. So what else is on here, male, female, basically. But these are some very interesting now subgroup analysis we're getting. And then here's one, another meta-analysis of all those trials. And what I want to point to here is the odds ratio for the benefiting from the therapy, very high, resulting in this kind of, p-value, extremely significant. But then you look at the downside, okay, mortality, endovascular group, 97, none of these, I think, were significant, but control group, more, okay, so more people die. So it's a trend. Symptomatic intracranial hemorrhage, 26, 28, more. Bad outcomes with the worst, right? Completely dependent, nursing home, vegetative, that thing. 139, way more than the people who didn't get it. So it looks to be a huge benefit with no risk. Yeah?
Time.
Okay, thank you. All right, so I think we're right on time. So this is just suggesting that as these trials went on, they got better and better outcomes because they were doing things. What were those things? One was lower time, because as you go down through those trials, lower and lower time to treatment. Another one was imaging. I think it's a little controversial, but they did rapid perfusion studies to try and select patients. In some ways, that might be cherry picking a little bit, where you're gonna get the best ones, but maybe you still could help some of those others too, so I'm not entirely convinced about this one. But then also just more effective devices and more rapid reperfusion once you're in the cath lab is shown as a trend through all these trials that got better and better. Okay, so based on all this, the Stroke Association came out with new recommendations that said patients should receive endovascular therapy. At that time they said with stent retriever, but we also have a suction device now, if they meet all the following criteria. When a group like the Stroke Association says that, what that essentially means is that's standard of care, and you're somewhat thin ice if you don't do it, because you're gonna get some expert that's gonna say, they should have done that. And that's the bottom line here. If you have a patient with a large vessel occlusion, you have the ability to go to an angio suite and do large, this type of therapy, and you don't, I think you might be a little bit at risk, exposing yourself a little bit to criticism. Okay, so these are the things we don't yet know what about, which means it's not that we know it's bad, it's just you use your judgment. A low baseline stroke scale. Maybe with speech, we'll go after a stroke scale of 3 or 4. Sometimes if it's really hitting speech heavy, but the question, the risk benefit, way far out there, the further out, same thing, the stroke scale will probably be lower and it's harder to get to. Bad aspect scores with a lot of damage on the CT scan, or late, presentations. They're not saying don't do any of these. They're just saying we don't know about these, all right? So This is the likelihood of good outcome plotted over time, and what we're seeing is 38% decrease for every 60 minutes. Okay, that is the bottom line. This TikTok document dealing with the stroke is that it's all about the time and getting that patient recanalized as soon as possible. So I say from CT to the angiography suite, stat. Or if you're transferring the patient, hold the truck on the scanner, get the TPA back in the truck and on their way out is the way you're gonna help. This is another way of looking at it. It's the number needed to treat as you move down the timeline. See, if we get them early, you're gonna help a lot of people, but the further out you go, the less likely chance you're gonna have. You know, it gets to be 14 when you get way out there. That's another way of looking at it. Here is a plot showing all the steps in this one paper and the average in a trial and, you know, to look at how can we improve. So here's the big problem, arrival to the hospital. Okay, so these are like 10-minute intervals, but here's 100 minutes. So the average person doesn't get to the hospital until 2 hours, right? That's a problem. When you get that one in the high stroke scale and you got them within 30 minutes, golden opportunity. Then from there until they get the CT, most people are getting pretty good, but you see some outliers, right? They didn't get the CT right away. Then to groin puncture, I'd like to see this shrunk. Sometimes it's too long, I want the patient off the table and on to the angio suite as soon as possible. Then once they're in the angio suite, they're just technical issues. Some cases go quicker than others. Most people are pretty good at this. There's not much we can do. And sometimes the case, you know, drags out for because it's difficult. But so these are the areas and the transfer where we can really make a difference. And again, for every 60 minutes, 38% decrease. Okay, let's see if this is gonna play. Here's a stroke case in progress at our hospital, and this is a crew that's experienced in knowing what they're doing. This is a, someone that's probably training because they're being watched, but you got all hands on deck, nurses, everybody doing their job, trying to move that case through as quickly as possible. All right, so if we make the effort, we can save these patients that would have had, you know, severe disability, basically, you know, to bring back their humanity. It's not, you know, not much more important any of us are doing than that. If we make the effort and get them recanalized as soon as possible, you will see some of these, I guarantee it. All right? Right on time. Thank you.
Yeah, can I ask, so you talked about a patient coming from another unit to yours. Now, us here, what can we do for our patients as far as
so you guys, maybe one of those came from here that I showed you. There's you have an automatic barrier at the transfer time. We can't do what we've been talking about. This is the big question, why we're here, why we're here. How can you get them to us as quickly as possible, and how can you do your end as quickly as possible? So my advice about recognizing by the high stroke scale or, you know, the clinical presentation, this is likely a large vessel occlusion. Hold the truck, get them on the scanner, give the IV TPA, put it back in the truck and get them out as soon as you can. That's what you can do.
So we do the tally. I work in the ICU, not the ED, but I do the tally neuro console in the ED. Is this sort of thing being discussed there?
Yeah, it's ongoing, isn't it? We do tele.
Right, but I mean,
so
in that conference, is the manual removal of a possibility brought up?
Oh, yeah. So Wendy can speak to that. So the first line typically is a neurologist for an outside. As an in-house stroke, a stroke patient goes off and everybody is CT, everybody hears about it. Right. When it's a consult, it's the poor neurologist at 2 a.m. that right. gets first hit. And so then that's what they're thinking. They need to be transferred. They need, there's a large vessel occlusion. That's like on the top of your mind, right? They deal with a lot of other strokes besides these rare few that we are the ones we can pick that are maybe not even a stroke, it could be a seizure and all kinds of things, right? But if it's a real stroke and a high stroke scale, that's what they're thinking. Is this a large vessel occlusion and we need to get that patient over? Right, Wendy? Is that fair enough? So that's what it's all about. And then it's just quickly. But what we unfortunately see sometimes is that all works fine. The patient was on the CT scanner in 30 minutes at the outside hospital. They caught the IV well within an hour, and then there's a 2.5 hour delay before they're on my angio table.
Right.
It just,
and
it's killing.
Our problem here.
Yeah. So how can we're open to ideas of how we can fix this problem. They get stuck in traffic if they're in an ambulance, or, you know, but we hear things like, oh, well, we sent the medic away and then it took an hour for them to come back. Okay, don't send them away, keep them there. This is a stroke case, stay right there. Or we heard one that's like, well, there was already just a medevac of a pediatric case, or waiting for the plane to come back or something like that, right? What can you do? So this is important. We need to get these patients. There's no way you're gonna set up with that room and the personnel and the number of staff required to do it. It has to be a hub. You got to get to the hub. And how we do it quickly is issue number one, I think. Aside from making everyone aware of that, you know, do your part as quickly as possible and recognize a large vessel occlusion.
Okay.
Oh,
I have a question.
The medical indications for this are pretty clear from the data, but as far as like financial sequelae come for the family, given that this is standard of care, does it generally have very good coverage? Families have a large burden of debt. How does that usually end up?
You know, I can't honestly speak to that, because fortunately, that doesn't usually enter my mind. You know, we do a lot of private standing, that sort of thing. I just do what I think is right. But I don't think in someone who's impoverished, it doesn't mean they don't get it. Sorry, you're just gonna have a stroke. Mm-hmm. They get it. And then I think it's like any other kind of emergent care that gets worked out about, you know, how it's gonna get paid for, if it's gonna get paid for. Mm-hmm. I suspect some of these aren't, right? They're just, or there's some backup, you know, reimbursement through the public means, you know. But so we don't, if someone's in the middle of a stroke, we don't first do a wall biopsy. Right, we have to get them treated. And do you know the answer to that, Wendy? I mean, do people end up, you know, bankrupt because they had a stroke and then they get stuck with a big bill? I'm not aware of that.
Yeah, no, I don't think it's quite kind of like the new way. You know, TPA, you know, I would say that it's standard care, go ahead and you know, you don't need consent necessarily. Here, I think, I'll try within reason to find out if someone available, but happy to, you know, again, we will be choosing to consent. But now it's becoming standard of care. I don't know if the guidelines have caught up yet.
I mean, I would guess the answer to that question is someone who falls through the donut hole, whatever, they have enough means that they're considered able to pay for it, even though they really can't, and they get hit with a big bill like any other.
May well be cheaper than long-term.
Well, there is that. Right, yeah, what, exactly. It's cheaper in the long run, for sure. Did you have a question?
Yes, what did you say about the wake-up strokes?
So the problem with that is, and I felt from the very beginning, is that is off the reservation on from the get-go. What's the time of onset? When they last went to sleep. That's the official answer. Someone, you know, suddenly bolts out of bed, rolls over, and tries to get up, and they can't get up at 4 in the morning, and they went to bed at 8 p.m., their time of onset's 8 p.m. That doesn't seem fair to me. Yeah. When you can say that patient is just like nothing. Yeah. And so, but the CT scan, if it's normal, I think that stroke happened when they bolted out of bed and, you know, they woke up because they were having a stroke. And so I think just a normal high aspect score is sufficient for me to give that patient a chance. But this is where maybe some more advanced imaging to try and rule that patient in, make them qualify by showing adequate collaterals, because this was a, you know, reason not to treat a lot of patients. Unknown time of onset. It doesn't have to be a wake-up stroke. Found. Same thing, right? It was the last time somebody else saw them, or unless they can tell you when it happened. Found down. So for all of those unknown time of onsets, and wake-up stroke being one of them, that's where the imaging comes in. But as far as I'm concerned, just a CT scan that's got a normal aspect score is a good sign that you can say that patient, we've seen that.
Okay, so in order to move on, what